open your hearts, come on.
Your hands up. You came with someone that is deaf or dumb. You came with somebody who is deaf or dumb. Can I see your hands up? Just keep worshiping. Keep worshiping. And all that thrills my soul is Jesus. He's more alive to me than the fairest of the far.
Is my sick
Lord and King, and all that thrills my soul. More than love to me. Hallelujah. And the fairest of the thousand. He my Savior, Lord and King.
It's deaf and dumb. Deaf. He can hear, he can speak. What about you? I need to know who brought him this. What can he do? She can't talk, she can't hear. Okay. From birth. Sit down. She can't hear. Can you please put them together, please? I want them together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight because of your love, and we give you praise because you want to do what your word says you will do. And for this, we trust you will do as the Holy Ghost moves again in our midst tonight. in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Sit down for a moment, please. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 1. I'm going to read just two verses. Now, the singers or the instrumentalists, get your seats here. Singers can join later on. Genesis 1, I'll read verses 1 and 2. Let's read together Genesis 1, 1 and 2. 1, 2, let's go. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Verse 3 says, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. One of the most profound revelations in the Bible is the concept of the Trinity of the Godhead. And tonight, I do not intend to expound on that, but just to mention that it is very scriptural to say you have three persons in the Godhead, three distinct, separate persons, well, totally united as one. They have different purposes or different roles, but the same purpose. And that's why you would see in Genesis chapter 1, the Bible says the earth was without form. It was shapeless. The earth was void. It was empty. And there was darkness. And the Bible says that in this state of formlessness, darkness, and emptiness, the Spirit of the Lord began to move on the waters. And the Bible says God spoke. So God spoke the living word that carried life. And the Spirit of the Lord that moved upon the waters began to change the state of the earth at this point in time. Without the Spirit of God, actions intended by the Father cannot be realized. The Spirit of God has a singular responsibility to move things, to shape things, to feel things as the Father intends. So He took hold of the earth and brought shape into the earth. He took hold of the earth and removed darkness from the earth. He took hold of the earth and filled the earth and removed void and emptiness. In the physical realm, you need some kind of force to change the states of substances. And one of the laws of physics says that you cannot move an object that is stationary without exerting a force on it. And once the object starts moving, you can't stop it except you exert a force on it. So to move something static, you need to apply force. To stop something in motion, you need to apply force. And that's what the laws of physical nature tells us. In the realm of the spirit, the same law holds. There's some kind of force that's required to change the state of things or to move things around, to fix things. So whenever God wants to move things or wants to shape things or to stop things, out of these things, the Spirit of God goes into action. It was the same Spirit that moved into action when Moses stood before the Sea of Pharaoh. I mean the Red Sea. The Bible says that as Moses raised up the rod, the power of the Lord hit the Red Sea. And the Bible says the Red Sea parted hither and thither. For a Red Sea that was covered up to have parted hither and thither, there had to be force exerted on it. So the Holy Ghost went into action and divided the Red Sea. And every time you see God in action, in the Bible days, in contemporary times, even in our day, you would see the Holy Ghost in action. And this day, this night, can somebody shout, Holy Ghost, do it again. If we who had just one child, I just lost the child, very sorrowful, as the child was conveyed to the place of burial. And there was this long entourage, convoy that went with her. The Bible says that Jesus met her on the way where this child was about to be buried. And Jesus spoke a word. The power of God went from what was said. It took hold of this dead child, and the Spirit of the Lord moved in the mortal body of this dead child that had died. And the Bible says this child came back to life. A force was exerted. The Holy Ghost is not a force, it's the person in the Trinity. But there's a force that changes things, and that's the force it releases. So this force was exerted on the child, and the child got back to life. That same force is here tonight. That same force is about moving in the dead womb of a woman who has been married for 15 years and has been believing the Lord for a child. And people have told you, woman, you're a man. You can't bear a child. You can't get pregnant. I want to announce to you tonight, when the Holy Ghost begins to move, it will move in the stomach, in the womb of that woman. And that woman shall get pregnant, and the woman shall conceive, and shall be delivered of a child. If you believe that, shout aloud, amen. Preaching somewhere some years ago, a few years back, and there was this man who was more like lifeless. He had stroke, his hands were paralyzed, his feet were paralyzed, and this man could not eat, couldn't drink. And when I saw this man, I'm sure the children felt that it was better for this man to have died than stay here. We needed to take him to the toilet to wee. We needed to take him to the toilet to poo. As for something to drink, they would struggle and struggle. And this man was there. He couldn't recognize a pin, somebody. The son brought him to me, and he brought me to him. And we went to two persons. And when we looked at him, I took my eyes off. Because it's not what I see. It's about what the Holy Ghost was about doing in his life. And I told the brother with me, lift up your hands, let's start worshiping. That's why I love to worship him. And as we're worshiping him, we're worshiping him for about 5-10 minutes. And I'm sure this brother was thinking, come on, we're very far from home. Let's quit this thing, get out of this place. We worshiped, and we worshiped. How we worshipped. And all of a sudden, we spoke a word. And when we spoke the word, the Holy Ghost took the word, took hold of the hands of this man, took hold of the feet of this man, took hold of the mortal body of this man, took hold of the throat of this man. And all of a sudden, this man showed signs he could recognize somebody. He could move his hands. He could move his feet. And I told him, hold on. I said, give this man something to drink and get him something to eat. And the sister of the young man that took me there said, Pastor, he doesn't drink nothing. I said, get him some Lucozade boost to drink. He said, Pastor, he does not even drink water. He struggles to drink. We have to force him. They got him a cup of Lucozade. I told him, by the way, get him his first food. I mean, his best food. And they went and got him pounding yam. Ready for him. They were getting that set. Right before us, they gave him the cup of Lucozade. This man who was more like paralyzed, grabbed the cup, held the cup, finished the cup, drank everything in the cup, and gave them the cup back. And the one that thrilled me so much. And I told him, right now, you're going to walk. He stood up. And he began to walk around the house. Round the house. Round the house. Round the house. Let somebody shout, Holy Ghost! Do it again! And we just left the place. We had to travel back to Port Harcourt. And I told him once he finished eating his food, he would sleep. And when he sleeps, leave him alone. This man had not gone to the toilet for about a week or 2 weeks or so, because he wasn't eating. And the sickness added to the problem. We hit Rumokoro and I got a call. He said, Pastor, as soon as you left, we got the pounded yam or whatever they made ready for him. And he ate this food for the first time. The moment he had the food, he slept off. And when he slept off, he woke up. After a few minutes or so, he got up, he went to the toilet, and for the first time, this man was doing that. Why? The Holy Ghost had taken hold of his feet, the force in his hands, took hold of his hands, took hold of his feet. Somebody shout, Holy Ghost! Do it again! If you understand the place of the Holy Ghost in our lives on earth, you just want to know him more. You want to relate with him. You want him to be your friend. When Jesus, your master, left, he handed you over to him. I don't see Jesus physically except he comes in a vision. But the Holy Ghost takes the place of Jesus and does for me all that Jesus would have done for me if I was on earth with him when he was here on earth physically. So when you look at the Bible, the scripture is replete with the acts of the Holy Ghost, the works of the Holy Ghost. I will never forget reading the life story of Benin and how this transformed my life so much. Only a few days ago, I had a member of my seminar class sharing with me a similar story. She said, Pastor, do you know I'm a pastor in my church? I said, I didn't know. He said, Pastor, do you know I'm the worst sinner on earth? I said, I don't understand. You can't be a pastor in your church and be the worst sinner on earth. For you to be a pastor, you must have been saved from sin. He said, Pastor, you don't understand. And she gave me a very pathetic story. Very pathetic story. She got messed up by her stepfather. And when she tried to explain the case to the mother thought that she wanted to create a problem in that family. She had never known her father because her father left when she was born for a country overseas. Before this time, because the Lord had something for her, the Holy Ghost would normally visit with her and would have such handsome experience. Sometimes as she moves around or makes contact with some people, they just drop under the anointing. But she was not very knowledgeable about these things then. She told her pastor, a Pentecostal church. Some of you know him. I'll mention his name. She told him, and when he listened to her, he said, the Lord has a call on your life. And she had such a beautiful experience with the Holy Spirit. She was developing that relationship as she grew up in a teenage space. Until the stepfather messed up. When the father finally came back, the very first time she was meeting with the father did the same thing to her. And from that day, it just went on and on and on and on. Because the father felt, made her understand that that's the way he could protect her. And she seemed to have believed him. Until the day she went to the church and the priest along this line, and she said, never again. She went back and said, the father, never again. But after that, she went on and on, because she said, if my stepfather and my own father have done this to me, I'm of no worth. So whenever men insist or beg, you just give it to them freely. And she's been doing that even though she's in church. And some things still happen while she does that. And she said, Pastor, the reason I do that is not because I want it, but because when they keep begging and begging, I'm so soft in heart. I think if my father took it, my stepfather took it, then these ones are just people on the street that are not so close to me. And the Lord opened up my eyes to understand that this was a vessel the enemy wanted to destroy. And I told her about the love of Jesus. I told her the love of Jesus will not let you go. I told her that the enemy wanted to ruin her life by making reference to the things she had in the past. And as I was talking, she was crying, mucka all over the face. And she was totally broken. I'm not saying spend such broken. She was totally broken, cried and cried and cried. And it was becoming embarrassing where we were. And I told the brother, come take her along with me. I went somewhere around the teenage church area. And just then I prayed with her, the power of God hit her. And she was in the anointing for quite a while. I left the place, went away. And when she woke up, she didn't see me. She sat on the chair where I sat. Now listen, something happened in the past when she was having such beautiful experience and interaction with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost would expand to her whatever the pastor taught her in such depth as a teen. And she had deep understanding of scriptures. Things she didn't understand, she would ask. Just the same way Benny explained. I will explain to her. And she kept growing. The power of God was so strong in her life. People did not understand the secret. Only a pastor knew that. But one day something happened. As she was talking with the Holy Spirit, she had the sound of the voice of a childhood friend. And she had not seen her for quite a while. The moment she heard her voice, she rushed out in excitement, grabbed her, embraced her. And then now when she realized that, she had just left her friend behind. So when she went back, her friend was gone. And usually, if she wants him around, she would worship and worship and worship. After deep worship, he will walk in and smile and sit with her, and they'll talk a while and pray. I mean, just talk a while, fellowship with him. But when this happened, she worshiped and worshiped and worshiped. Her friend didn't come back. The Holy Ghost was great. And after several days, he came on his own. And when he came, he wasn't smiling like usual. And said, do you know what you did? You loved your friend more than me. I was talking with you and you left me and you went after your friend. And I just can't take that. Because I can't take that, I will open up your eyes and you'll be understanding things yourself. I don't need to explain to them to you anymore the way I used to. And from that day, it stopped coming, but she was still having such deep revelations. But that night, something happened. As soon as I left the place, she got up, she sat down. The Holy Ghost walked in again. And this time, for the first time in so many years, was smiling at her. Beaming with smile. And when she smiled at her, she did this and walked away. And the moment he did that, all of those strong, powerful anointings she felt, they traveled all over her, that she lost when she went into sin, immediately returned. Her hands were born with fire 2 days ago. Yesterday she saw me say, Pastor, she was almost jumping. I mean, oh, Pastor, my friend is back. It's all, I mean, he came back. My hands are burning, my feet are burning, the entire, you know, all the experience he used to have before. What a merciful God we have. Someone who had messed up and messed up and said, Pastor, I'm worthless. I'm worse than a sinner, even though I'm a pastor. She came broken, and the Lord saw her heart. The Lord restored her. There's somebody here today who is hearing the sound of my voice. It seems to you you've gone so far. You're a backslider. You messed up your life. You've gone so far and so deep. And something is telling you, this is the last night. Tomorrow you would have left this place and your life will not be changed. I want to announce to you, Holy Ghost, it's about doing again in your life. If it did in the life of that sister, it will do it in your life. You are about being restored. You are about being restored. You are about being restored. The power of the Holy Ghost is restoring you tonight. If you believe that, shout amen. Sit down. I read in the scriptures and I saw mighty things the Holy Ghost has been involved in. Grabbed Lazarus, 4 days in the grave, kicked him out. An angel appeared to a woman and said, you would have a child. She said, have a child? I don't have a husband. He said, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. It is impossible with men. But when the Holy Ghost is in action, when the Holy Ghost is in action, when the Holy Ghost is in action, that which is impossible in the sight of men shall become possible. I want to announce to somebody today, somebody has seen you and there are many remarks that you have finished. They've seen you and they think they've seen your hand. They've seen you and they said, this man, from all our assessment and from all we know about him, from all we know about your background, you'll move nowhere in life. I want to announce to you, when the Holy Ghost takes hold of your life today, he shall make a Joseph out of you. He shall make a Paul out of you. He shall make a Hell of you. If you believe that, shout aloud, amen. You know, I thank God for what the Holy Ghost is still doing today. I'm so thankful to God. To have been in some of those meetings, I see what he does. Saturday night was so glorious here. Oh, when our father preached and prayed, we had lots of people that were healed. Lumps disappeared. Their feet were strengthened and they could rise up and they could walk. Sight was restored. And several others we couldn't take. Well, brethren, one of the greatest pains of my heart is looking at where the church is today and comparing to where we're coming from. I know there are people who don't like the pastor, stop talking about the past. These are new days, yes. If you saw the things I saw when I gave my life to Christ in the early 80s, 81. If you read the things I read at that point in time, you know that what we are seeing today is still just what? Tip. And that's why I am like Gideon that is asking, where are the miracles which our fathers told us about? I got 71 and I began to read about where the church is coming from. I read a life story of William and Sarah Booth of the Salvation Army Church. I saw how the force of the Holy Ghost took over that mission and literally almost took over the world. I read about him, Charles Finney, how the power of God came upon his life, how the voltages of the Holy Ghost came upon him, and how he would move around in a factory and said nothing, say no word, just his eyes making contact with the eyes of the workers who walked after the order. And as your eyes made contact with his eyes, you dropped down under the power of conviction and you began to cry. And one after the other, they all dropped. And the manager of the office, who had made a mockery of this old bowed-head preacher, suddenly announced, "Let's keep religion in place. Let's keep religion in place." Because the Holy Ghost seized that company and they closed down the factory. I read about those things. I read about the lives of God's servants. I read about A. Allen. I read about John Gillick. I read about people that literally shook this earth with the power of God in their lives. And as I read each of them, it just blows my mind. It blew my mind. I was fortunate to be in the meetings of T.L. Osborne, attending meetings of Richard Roboth, attending meetings of some great other evangelists of those days. I attended the Deeper Life Revival in the 1881s. I attended Crusades of Bonkin. And every of these meetings I attended, I saw the Holy Ghost in action in such a manner that corroborates scriptures. And I said, the things I see are the things I read in scriptures. John 16 verse 9 tells me that the Holy Ghost will convict the world of sin. So when I see Finney under such intense anointing, not speaking a word, but just looking, and the power of God convicted sinners and they broke down in tears weeping. There was a city the Holy Ghost took hold of, and every sinner gave his life to Christ. Crime was totally wiped off. Police did not have job to do because criminals got convicted under the power of the Holy Ghost. You didn't have foreigners. You didn't have kidnappers. You didn't have armed robbers. Why? Because the force of the Holy Ghost took hold of the hearts of men. And men did not see any need, any good in doing bad. Their lives were transformed. There was literally zero crime because the fear of God took over the land. When I look at that and I think about what happens today, where you speak and you give an altar call and three friends are walking with their hands in their pockets and they're jesting, they're laughing, they're talking about one girlfriend they met yesterday, yet they're going to the altar. And when they get to the altar, they are told, "Say after me, Lord Jesus." And as they're talking, they're hitting themselves. And we see this lots of time. They come to the altar, they leave the altar, their lives are not changed. It pains my heart. When I see comedians invited to God's church and they stand at God's holy altar and they're making a mockery of scriptures, make a mockery of God's servants, and God's servants laugh, put their legs up, my heart broke when a sister in one of the churches, one of the biggest churches in Nigeria, told me of a comedian. Now he came for the night watch. I said, "Comedian in a night watch? What business has comedian got to do with night watch?" He said, "Pastor, that's the way to keep the people awake." Ah, you need a comedian to keep people awake? It broke my heart. So when I read about these things, and I see the things I see today, and when I do a comparison, I'm like Gideon who is asking, where are the things we were told about those things? Pastor, if you're here today, hearing my sound, my voice, you should be concerned. There's gradually a celebration of sin and immorality in the church. And pastors have to play along, because once you begin to preach the message of the cross, you become the enemy of the church. People start leaving the church. They want to go to somewhere where it's supposed to go when something is happening. Even if they've been told every day you'll make money. That's what they want to hear. Whether they leave or not, I've made up my mind. The whole rugged cross must be preached. On the hill, far away, stood a whole rugged cross. The emblem of suffering and shame. Chapter 3, verse 18. It tells me when we behold the glory of the Lord as in a glass, we are changed from glory to glory into the same image. And that tells me of the transformation the Holy Ghost wrought when I behold the face of Jesus. There is a total change of life when a man gives his life to Christ. The Holy Ghost does it. And not just that, when we are changed from sin to saint, he starts transforming our lives from glory to glory, from glory to glory. I will never forget reading the life of a small girl. I read a book 3 times. And each of those times I read the book, I broke down in tears. Because this was a 14-year-old, 15, 16-year-old girl. God saved 14 years, died 22 years. Lived such a short life. But she had learned to behold the glory on the face of Jesus. And as she beheld the glory on the face of Jesus, our life got changed, so changed into the same image of His glory. So I just reached out till my throne is at last. Tiny looking 15, 14 year old girl. She had looked on the face of Jesus. As she literally spent time over and again with Jesus. And as she beheld the glory of God, her life carried the same image. And if everyone bows his head to pray right now, a small, tiny Elenhewa comes tiptoeing. Without hearing the sound of her shoes, something just sees this atmosphere. The glory of God, like the same glory that was in the Ark of the Covenant, which a tiny body carried, suddenly began to be released in the atmosphere. 100 meters away from sinners on campus, as they discussed sin, they suddenly felt something happening around the atmosphere. They knew that Ellen Emma must be on her way to the campus. And they watched to see where. And there she comes with a small, tiny body moving around. because the Holy Ghost had transformed life. Elihua was not a singer like you. Elihua was not a preacher like me. She was not even a worker in the church. But in her days, preachers like Adeboye and Omar Bai and Benin at this, if they wanted to hold a program like this, they invited that teenager to come to their meetings. They did not ask her to sit with the pastors. They did not ask her to sit with the choir. They only requested that she stand somewhere in the crowd. Wherever she stood, the glory of God she had carried radiated in the entire atmosphere. And as long as Helen was around the place, they felt the tangible anointing. And that was what they wanted. Why? The Holy Ghost had transformed her from glory to glory. Can someone shout, Holy Ghost, do it again. 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 Stand and say, do it again. Stand and say, do it again. Stand and say, do it again. Do it again in my life. Do it again in my life. As I'm leaving this camp, oh Lord, I want to carry your glory. Holy Ghost, do it again in my life. Somebody pray. Holy Ghost, do it again. Do it again in my life. Open my eyes to see Jesus seated upon the throne. The power of God is in the house. The power of God is in the house. Lift up your hands and receive the power that transforms you. Lift up your hands and receive the power that transforms you. Lift up your hands, receive the power that changes you. Lift up your hands, receive the power that conforms and makes you of the same image like Him. Somebody receive it now. Help them, help them, help at the back. Help at the back, help at the back. Open my eyes to see Jesus seated upon the throne. There's somebody here. You step on a liquid that looked like Coke or tea, and you thought it was something just normal. But from that day, you develop a problem in your legs. Before I finish preaching, the power of the Holy Ghost will locate you, and that problem in the leg is over. In the name of Jesus. When I start praying, I want to come out. I want to see you because I want to touch you. See that. Apart from convicting sinners and transforming lives into the image of God's glory, the Holy Ghost, from what I read, from what I saw, also gives powerful witnesses of Jesus Christ. It made powerful witnesses of Jesus Christ. Come on! I read about James Stewart. I will never forget that book as a teen. The title of the book was, I Must Tell. I Must Tell. The passion of the world, the gospel, to see sinners saved was on this young man, youth. And we go to the marketplaces, places like my one, go to areas where you had talks. And all the stubborn guys, they would stand, the drunks, as he stood to preach. Sometimes they hurl stones at him. Don't throw stones at him. He will stand and preach passionately with tears. I want you to give your life to Christ. Some time ago, preaching in the bus from Aba to Port Harcourt. Port Harcourt to Aba was your job. You enjoyed doing it. You entered the bus at my one. And you went all the way to Obigbo. And you preached the word. Today there seems to be a sacred collusion for us to be quiet. We see that in the cars, see that in the taxis, see that in the buses. And everyone seems to have agreed that we must take it easy. And nobody is talking anymore. The money cries we used to hear, they have almost died. The machines for the money cries are even no more. Something seems to be happening. But in this space, God is worried. He said, where are the witnesses? Where are my witnesses? How will they hear if nobody tells them? How will they go except they've been sent? And God is saying, I want to send them today. I want to anoint them today. I want to make powerful witnesses of my children. Acts chapter 1 verse 8 tells us that we can become witnesses unto Jesus Christ. And you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be my witnesses. Tonight, the Spirit of God tells me He wants to do it again. He wants to restore the fire in your heart to preach the word. He wants to restore the anointing in your life to stand in the bus, to preach boldly, to stand in the taxi, to preach boldly. That power is coming back to you tonight. If you believe it, shall the Holy Ghost do it again. We enter the buses. And sometimes we had nothing else to do but just to enter the bus and preach. From Maitu to Oshodi. From Oshodi back to Maitu. Maitu to Oshodi. Oshodi back to Maitu. And sometimes from Maitu to Ojo. We're just enjoying as teenagers. Dishing out the word. And that's why I weep. When I see my teens friend all around this place, they know my. They feel that pastor is just unnecessarily hard. They feel that pastor is disturbing them. Some of them, once they see me, they stand up, they start running. I'm not a masquerade. It's just that whenever I see you, I remember my teens. I remember the days of my thing when I was like you. And the joy of my heart was to move in from one bus to the other with all of the energy, preaching the word powerfully throughout with the buses going around the place. So when I see you holding a girl or crossing that gate to go and mess around with a girl, it pains my heart. But I believe tonight the Holy Ghost will take hold of your life. You will come to this altar and you will say, Father, change my life. If you are saying that, shout aloud, amen. When I read in God's word, the Holy Ghost reveals secrets. It revealed hidden things. It gave guidance to the church. And that helped the church to be pure. When the Pentecost was fresh, I'm talking about the Pentecostal church you have today. The first one, when it has started, Holy Ghost killed some people. They came to church and they were telling lies. Say, you don't lie to the Holy Ghost. Ananias dropped dead. Sapphira dropped dead. Because he opened the eyes of Peter and said, they can't lie here. We find ourselves today in a generation where people come to the altar, pregnant, and they say, I do. God's prophets, like me, are blind. We can't see them. And we say, this is the best Christian. It was a prayer warrior. It was a firebrand. Not understand the mess up themselves before they came to the altar. And just 6 months later, we hear that the wife has been delivered of a baby. How did that happen? Not premature, because they deceived me and deceived the church. When a generation where witches and wizards now sit down with pastors and deacons and deaconesses, and they're clapping their hands and jumping and dancing like you. When they dance like you in church, they go back and they join their friends to punish people. One of my leaders those days when I was a seasonal pastor told me what happened. They used to have a prayer meeting in a church. A Holy Ghost church, I mean, holiness church in this town. They usually have old night vigil in the church. And that night, as they went to pray, they went to sleep before the night vigil. He was sleeping, he felt a weight on him. And when he felt that weight on him, he couldn't stand. All he noticed was that he would just see something like a bird. Pop. To change to human being. Pop. To change to human being. He was saying, no, get up. He couldn't get up. And they sat down in that church, Holiness Church, and they were talking, they were having a meeting. He couldn't hear what they were saying, but all he heard was, yeah. After about 30 minutes or so, they took off. That's when now keep up. Ah, so witches are holding meeting. They chose to hold meeting. Child. They left garbage sites that look like them. They chose to come and hold a meeting in a holiness church. And when I heard that, it broke my heart. I said, where is Elijah? Where are those prophets that the Holy Ghost anointed to pronounce judgments? Where is that believer that the Holy Ghost has come upon and he can see and say, Pastor, something is happening in this church where it's decreed that the next time any witch will step on this church, it dies. They come to church on Sunday morning, but it's dancing. If you look around me, you will see my Lord Jesus. Look around me, you will see my Lord. Yes, Jesus is there. But when they have gone, witches come and sit down there. It's not Jesus, it's witches. Something has happened to the church that armed robbers can freely come into church and collect money from members during service and go away. Sometimes they even come and carry God's property and go. That's why I pity those youths who went to Camp David to do what they did. I just pity them. Because this night, when we begin to call the Holy Ghost to do it again, there'll be an uproar in the realm of the Spirit. So the Holy Ghost was a revealer of secret and where necessary judgment that was pronounced, he executed it instantly. Enough of sitting down comfortably with witches and wizards. Enough! God's house is not a place for the witch. God's house is not a place for the wizard. God's house is a holy ground and shall be revered by every man and every woman. If you believe that, shout amen. You know, until a certain church got angry, the leader of the prayer team was actually a witch. And once they start praying, fire, she was doing that. But what the church observed was that youths were just dying, and the youth said, come on, we can't be dying like this. We are far from 70. Those who are still 40, 50 are still alive. We can't die like this. And they said, Holy Ghost must do it again. Holy Ghost, do it again. They went to pray. They took one full week and they said, Father, Holy Ghost, do it again. Holy Ghost, do it again. Holy Ghost, do it again. Touches my heart when I see my youth friends 7 days in a week eating all the meals, not observing any day to fast, and wasting the day of your youth where you have so much energy to move around and do things for God. And fathers, you see around, there are things they can't do anymore. They love to do it, but they can't do it because their strength is fading. And the youth in this church said, no, we can't take this. We can't take this. They're not sitting down there analyzing how church is going. We want to make the church modern. Our church is too old. We're too old-fashioned. We need to change. They're not doing that. I used to attend one God-forsaken church in Lagos. I'm sorry to say this. Where, well, it's not a God-forsaken church. Maybe it is the youth that has issues with. The youth were not happy with what the elders were doing. The pastors were quite hushed. And, you know, 70 years, 50 years, they wanted a dynamic church. They wanted to be like the young church. And they said, come. They said, the Bible says that violence take it by force. You know what they did? They went to the altar, literally dragged the Jew, say, come, we're overthrowing you. Go and sit down. I'm talking about the church. I'm not telling stories. I'm talking about the church. They removed him. Say, go and sit down. That you have tried. I wonder if this youth who are handling this issue. The Bible says, this youth began to pray. Father, Holy Ghost, do something about this. And one day, this sister was leading prayers as usual in the church. Fire. She missed one step. She missed two steps. They thought it was the anointing. She missed three steps. Missed four steps. It was when she collapsed. He said, ha. Our leader. She said, "Shai, fire on my head, oh, fire is burning. Fire on my bottle, fire is burning. Fire on my hands, fire on my belly, fire, fire. Fire. Now you declare fire just now. So if the fire is burning, something is wrong." It was then she confessed that she had been a witch, destroying the youth in the church, taking their lives one after the other. But for the Holy Ghost that intervened and exposed the secret, more youths would have died. That's why tonight we'll call down the Holy Ghost and we'll call down judgment, which he will execute in Jesus' name. Romans 8 verse 11 tells me that if the spirit that raised up Jesus, dwells in you, come on, this same spirit will what? Quicken your mortal bodies. There are people whose bodies need quickening. One of the things I read the Holy Ghost do was it quickened the bodies of people. Quickened their bodies. I watched Glorious yesterday. I like watching such things. I watched hands that were shot. And as the preachers held the hands, and the Holy Ghost quickened their hands and said, "This hand, you are too short." And the hands began to grow. I've seen that once. The hands began to grow. And I saw this over and over. I said, this Holy Ghost can't do anything. Tonight, if you are paralyzed, that spirit of Christ that dwells in you, when it's activated tonight, it will quicken your mortal bodies. Your foot, your hands, your neck, your waist shall receive a quickening. Shall receive a quickening. In the name of Jesus. If you're deaf, the force of the Holy Ghost will take hold of your ears and remove everything that has stopped your hearing. If you're dumb, something is holding your tongue from speaking. That same Holy Ghost will take hold of the tongue and loose the tongue. If you have a fibroid in your body, it will take hold of that fibroid. The force of the Holy Ghost, it will collapse that fibroid and take it out of your body. Saturday was glorious. Growth disappeared. And you know you don't understand it because you're not affected. Is that person who knows what is there. Somebody say, Pastor, don't you believe me? I say, I believe you. You say, what is that? The pastor, this thing has gone. Those were the sort of things we had on Saturday night. And this night I want to speak to everyone that is sick. Look up to Jesus. He's the healer. Look up to him. The Father wants you healed. The Son wants you healed. When the word is pronounced, the word is life. Peter and John stood before that man at the beautiful gate. And he said, silver and gold we don't have, but such as we have, give we thee. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the man made an effort to walk as they grabbed his hands. He made an effort to walk as they grabbed his hands. And as he exercised that faith that I want to walk, the Holy Ghost quickened the bones, the muscles, the tendon, all the things that need to move in his bones began to walk. When meeting where there was this lady who had clutches, and the mighty power of God felt the weight was seen in some things. But I'm sure she just felt that, come, my own is different. This one's that different. My own is different class. I'm saying these things to encourage you who are in front here. So when we called her to sick, she didn't come out. She stood where she was with her clutches. Instead of climbing like this, let me just stay with her. When the miracles began and one after the other, people were testifying, shouting, praising Jesus, all of a sudden I saw somebody with clutches at the altar. I said, now you have come to God's glory. The Holy Ghost took hold of that girl. The next thing I saw was that she dropped her clutches and this girl began to walk. She came obsessed with her clutches. When the Holy Ghost took hold of her feet, she went down without her clutches. And I just want to praise you, Lord. I'm going to lift my voice and say, I love you. You right with me. So be things the Holy Ghost does is that it comes upon weak men and make them strong men, anointed men. It comes upon weak men, weak vessels, those who see themselves as weak in their eyes. And when it's done with them, when it's done with them, they become different people. And I'm taking time to emphasize the fact that these are weak men. Even those men you call heroes of faith, look at them again. Hebrews 11. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I give you praise, Lord Jesus. Hebrews 11, verse 22. Somebody shout amen. When you read Hebrews 11, let's read from verse 33. We start from verse 32. It says, and what shall I say more then? What shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson and of Jephthah and of David also and Samuel and all of the prophets. He said, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions. They did all this by the power of the Holy Spirit. Quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness were made what? Strong. Waxed valiant in what? Fight. These are heroes of faith. But all the wonderful things you hear about them, the one that strikes me most is that at one time they were weak. If God loves any man, one of the things God will do to that man is to strip the man of his strength. God will strip you of your strength. God does not like strong people. Go through scriptures. 1 Corinthians 1:26. God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. So whenever God sees a man that is weak, he has seen a candidate in his hands for something awesome. And one of the things the Holy Ghost does, which I read about, which I also see in scriptures, and I've also seen in our times, is that it takes weak men, he anoints them and make them mighty vessels. Moses was too strong for God. He saw an Israelite being punished, grabbed the Egyptian, killed him. And the scripture says that he expected them to have known that this Moses is out for something good. Because he already got signs that there was something at stake. God said, this Moses will embarrass me one day. He's too strong for me. I want to plead with you tonight. Drop your strength. One of the keys to God using a man is when he has been relinquished, stripped of his strength. God has drained him of his strength. In him, it says nothing. His total and utter dependence is on God. He said, God, I'm totally nothing without you. Please feel me. And Holy Ghost is looking for such men tonight. He's looking for such women tonight. The Bible says God sent Moses packing out of the palace. Sent him into the bush when he had dealt with him. He said, Moses, go now to Pharaoh. Go and tell him that I sent you. He must let my people go. Moses said, me? Pharaoh? How do we? It doesn't happen that way. He said, God, I can't go. He said, I can't go because I'm a stammerer. I don't know how to talk. I cannot stand before Pharaoh. And God said, yes, I found a vessel. When we start praying tonight, please, I beg you, as you come before the altar, open up your heart and empty yourself before God. This was the secret in the lives of people like Evan Roberts. Evan Roberts was that great revivalist in Wales. The force behind the Welsh revival. One of those days, he was so hungry for God's power. He said, Holy Ghost, I've heard about you. I've heard about you. I've heard the things you've done. I've heard the things you've done. I want it in my life. I want it in my life. I want it in my life. And they told him that, come, you need to attend evening meetings as long as you are alive, because you don't know the day will come. So 14 years, he kept attending evening meetings without fail. And one day, the Holy Ghost gripped him. He began to cry. And when his sister or brother was asked to close the meeting, he said, oh Lord, bend me. The moment he heard that, those words, bend me, Evans busted out into tears and cried profusely. Because the Holy Ghost told him, that is what I need you to do. Bend, I want you to bend. Not bend physically, I want to bend in your spirit for me, so I can deal with you. And he continued that prayer the next day. And all of a sudden, the power of the Holy Ghost came upon him. It was literally on fire for him. And that was what birthed the Wales revival. Revival in Wales. Because this man got to a point where he said, God, I'm nothing. I want something. The Holy Ghost is in the business of raising men, pouring his anointing upon them, and making them strong. Jeffrey brothers were mightily used of God. You must have heard about them. They came into meetings and people like this didn't have to wait for too long. They just said, Jesus is here. The moment they said, Jesus is here, you start hearing rattling noise. You start hearing people screaming. Wow. They did not need to preach long sermons like what I'm doing right now. The power of God seized them. Caught them walking. Opened their eyes. Opened their ears. Opened their mouths. They got healed. One of those days, Stephen Jeffrey was preaching. And he began to laugh like my pastor Briggs does. Laugh, was laughing in the Holy Ghost. And he saw a man that was lame, jumped down, pounced on the man, grabbed the man, stand on your feet. The man stood and started walking around the place. Those are the things that the Holy Ghost did, and we are saying, Holy Ghost, do it again. Spirit Wigglesworth was a weak, illiterate man who couldn't preach. The wife did most of the preaching in church. He would just watch as the husband sit in church and nothing was happening. And one day, a friend told him that, come see what is happening in Sunderland. There's a mighty move of God. Let's go and see what's happening. He went there and said, I want the tongues. They said, no, that you want the baptism. He said, no, I have baptized. He said, no, I want the tongues. I've been baptized already. He went into arguing with them. His friend got angry and said, come, I brought you here for something and you are arguing with us and you don't even want to receive. Both of them went under the empty. In fact, they were so angry with each other that once walk on that road, the other walk on this road, they were going home. Hungry. They got home that night and they said, let's pray. And they prayed that night for about 4 hours. The next day they went back there to cut a long story short. He got frustrated. He was about leaving. He told the woman in charge of that meeting that I'm leaving because I have not got the tongues. And the woman said, it's not the tongues, it's the baptism of fire you need. He said, no, I'm baptized already. I want the tongues. He knelt down. The woman laid hands on her. And he began to speak in such glorious tongues. Oh, his heart was so filled with joy. When he got back home, the wife looked at him. He said, you think that you have received Holy Ghost baptism? He said, yes, I've received the Holy Ghost. He said, well, if you think you've received the Holy Ghost, you are a joker. Now, you in the past, you and I had gone out to do it together. But this time around, I'll allow you to do it yourself. I'll sit you and watch. As me said, I'll take that challenge. He stood before God's altar. He read the scriptures. And when he read the scriptures, the Spirit of the Lord has come upon me. As he read the scripture, the wife became uncomfortable. They said, this is not my Smith. She left the seat, went to sit somewhere at the corner and listened to Smith preach. Midway to the message, he said, this is not my Smith. The power of God was so strong upon his life. Midway to the message, the head of admin got up and said, I want this thing Smith has got. And as he was coming forward, he was hit down by the power of God. 14 others went under the power. The wife who was bossing was one of them. She was totally slain under God's power. And this was how this man that was weak, illiterate, suddenly had his life turned around because the Holy Ghost did something in him. Can someone shout, Holy Ghost, do it again? No wonder one of those days he came back from one of his meetings. You can see that for a moment, please. He came back from one of his meetings. And as he came out of the meeting, he met the wife sleeping, but the wife had died. Darling, she was gone. Said, why? Because you've described this place called heaven and you want to go back, I will allow you. And she dropped. Bye bye. That's how he permitted the wife to die. May God get us to that point tonight where dead people would not die at their own accord. We would have to join hands with them and say, well, we agree that you should die. And when we don't agree, we say it's not time for you to die. May God begin that with us tonight in the name of Jesus. It takes something. I love my chavda who lives in as a church in Charlotte, North Carolina. He has raised about 23 dead persons. But the first dead person he raised, he paid the price for it. My time is up. I see that, and I think we'll have to pray very soon. I have to stop where I am. Stop. Mine was about traveling to East Africa with Derek Prince. And just before the trip, the wife had a premature baby. They didn't expect the baby at 6 months. So he thought he would go and come back and then he would see the wife, you know, when he's back. But the wife had a baby, premature baby, 6 months old, just a week before he traveled. And when he was about leaving, he was thinking, I promised Derek, my spiritual father, that I'll go with him. I will go with him. I will go with him. The wife looked at him and said, darling, please, you can go. So you can go. He looked at the wife who was having a real serious health challenge. Looked at her. Look at Bonnie, the first child. Premature child in the incubator. He embraced the wife and said, darling, may God keep you for me. When I come back, I'll see you. May God heal your body. Looked at Bonnie in tears. He said, Bonnie, I may not meet you when I come back. But if I don't meet you when I come back, I'll see you in heaven. Took his bag, joined Derek on the trip, and went to East Africa. The first meeting they had, 30,000 crowd. The word came from Derek. He said, Marge, the Lord tells me you do twice what you are saying tonight. The friends I'm meeting had great meetings. And Marge moved on to his own meeting. He had about twice the size of that congregation. God had begun to do something. And the very first meeting, as he was preaching, some witches and wizards were gathering somewhere in the bush, encounting against him to destroy him. And all of a sudden, he didn't know about that. They saw balls of fire leave from the crusade ground. Whoop! Went straight to the bush, cut down the tree, burned it in fire. All the witches there died except one. And that was the one that ran to the crusade ground to say, my, please, I'm sorry. We're trying to kill you, but we all died except me. God fought for him because God had seen his what? Sacrifice of love. So when we are saying that the Holy Ghost will come and do the things he wants to do, we also have a part to play. As far as this matter is concerned, in fact, in that crusade, that was where my saw the first dead person rise up. The Lord gave him a word that there's a child here that died. The father went to the mortuary to get him from the mortuary and brought him here today. You are there with the child. The power of God is quickening you. All of a sudden, the child coughed and stood up. And from that day, marriage began to erase dead persons with ease. This anointing is not meant for marriage only. It's meant for you. It's meant for her. And that's why now when we start praying, you cry to God and say, God, Holy Ghost, do it again in my life. What pains my heart is that we see all of these things sometimes in trickles. We see God's servants in before our eyes today moving such anointings. People like Adeboye, like Kumuyi, Umahokpa, like our father, we see them move in these realms. The question I have is that how long shall we have them in the same? Adeboye is over 70 years. Kumi is all gray. Not the man I used to know when I was a teen. As for Rehoboth is gone. Kenan Hagin is gone. Theonos, I'm not sure about the state right now. A lot of these preachers that the Lord used in this space are going. And the thing that pains the soul is that you have young men of 13, 20, 24 years who are carrying titles that are heavier than their heads. Anytime I see a young man, and I respect God in their life, or when I see those titles lying before their thin name, fear catches me. Because I'm not sure if they'll survive the challenging ministry. So these men are passing away. They are going one after the other. And our fathers will see very soon, in 30 years to come, in 40 years to come, even less than that, they will go. And when they go, the question is that who are those persons whose heads are ready for the Holy Ghost to come and do this work in their lives? Apart from enduring men like we've seen, all the great servants of God, there were some awesome things the Holy Ghost did as he gave gifts to men, diverse gifts. Can't go into that tonight. My time is fast spent. I read about a 16-year-old girl, Isabel Vincent. She would quote scriptures she never read through the power of the Holy Spirit. She'll be sleeping while she's sleeping. She's singing as she's preaching. And people are hearing her preaching while she's sleeping. And they're getting seized, convicted in their hearts. Break down in tears. And she only wake up to see people in tears, crying to God for mercy. Those are some awesome things the Holy Ghost does. I've been to Randy Clark meetings twice now. And he talks about a phenomenon. It was very much instrumental in a move in Toronto, the Toronto Blessing. So glad to have that man put his hands on my head. And when he shared the story of this cloud, he said, whenever that cloud comes in his meetings, in fact, the first time it came, he was totally confused, didn't know what to do. But later I got to understand that cloud was a cloud of glory. And once it came like that, in that dust cloud, as many as stepped into that cloud, whether lame or deaf or dumb or blind, something happened. The force of the Holy Ghost took hold of them and healed them. These are phenomena our fathers have experienced. And tonight we are saying, Holy Ghost, do it again. Tonight, I want to stop you. I'm looking for men like me. I'm looking for women who are hungry, who want to see the Holy Ghost do things in their lives. Whether to quicken their mortal bodies or to make them powerful witness of God. I'm looking for men who have sent Holy Ghost, that anointing that Chasfini had that brought conviction to sinners as a priest. I want that to work in my life. I'm looking for women who are saying, Pastor, that force I had in me that moved me to preach the word powerfully in buses, in taxis, in cars. Oh God, I want that anointing. Now please, ushers, help me. I want this place free. I want this place free. I want this, just make this free.